So in the first lecture, we talked about generating functions and about kind of tools you can use to study sequences of numbers with the goal of understanding growth functions of groups. And then in the second lecture, yesterday I still wasn't talking about groups really, but was looking at geometric counting problems, the Gauss circle problem, and then Ehrhart polynomials. So let me just remind you. I like to call this round counting, pointy counting. And the idea was to sort of understand this dichotomy that you have, if you have something, the disk or something sufficiently smooth, and remember this notation means you do the lattice enumerator, the lattice point, you count the number of integer coordinate points in the nth dilate of the region, in this case the disk. And in this case, we get, we think, pi n squared plus something on the order of n to the 1/2 plus epsilon. So the question mark really goes here. But we know this is the leading term. And so we know that this has transcendental growth. OK, and just humor me because it's, well, there's a lot going on. What does that mean again? Transcendental growth means? So not only the generating function can't be expressed as a rational function, but that would just be that it's irrational growth. But transcendental growth goes a little further than that. Anybody remember how to say what transcendental growth means? Well, what makes a number that's irrational? What makes a number transcendental as opposed to algebraic?
Satisfies no polynomial.
Satisfies no polynomial with integer coefficients. Okay. So what makes a generating function transcendental as opposed to just irrational?
No recursion.
That would be for rationality. Oh, good. I'm glad we're going over this again. So what makes it transcendental is that that function itself satisfies no polynomial with polynomial coefficients. Right? So let me just remind you how that works. So if you had something rational, a of x is p of x over q of x, then you could rewrite that as qa minus p equals 0. I've just rewritten this. And so that means a rational generating function, can everybody see this? A rational generating function satisfies a linear polynomial with polynomial coefficients. So more generally, an algebraic generating function satisfies a higher degree, possibly, polynomial with polynomial coefficients. OK, so transcendentality of growth is really a very strong analog of transcendentality of numbers. And we have this theorem of Stahl's that tells us that if you grow like a power and your coefficient is transcendental, then the generating function is transcendental in this sense. It's not obvious, but it's true. It's actually just also a very short, nice proof. It's in this paper of Stahl's from, I think, 1996. That's really beautiful, and I recommend, if you're interested in growth, that you get to know Stahl's work. OK, so that was one side of the dichotomy, round counting. And then the point counting side, everything looks really different on this side of the world. So this side of the world was you do the enumeration for a polytope, a rational polytope. So again, you take a polytope with rational coefficients in R to the D, and then you dilate it, you multiply it by n, and you count the lattice points inside it. And this is an eventually quasi-polynomial. In fact, I don't even think you need the E. This is just a quasi-polynomial. So this has rational growth. So that's the dichotomy that I want to explore now. So today we finally get to groups. And we're going to think through this dichotomy. So we're going to sort of be asking ourselves morally, are groups round or pointy? Okay. Okay, so let me say a bit about groups. I already previewed some of the setup in the first lecture. It's that I want to take a group given by and relations. So let me put on the board three kind of prototype group regimes and talk a little bit about counting in these settings. So one group that I keep drawing pictures of that we know and love is the group. So this is the group Z squared. So it's got two generators, A and B. They commute. So this notation, this isn't the Lie bracket. This is the group theoretic commutator. So when I write the bracket of A and B, what I mean is AB, A inverse, B inverse. In other words, when two things commute and you write this symbol, this vanishes. Okay, so you should think of the commutator of two group elements as kind of measuring their failure to commute. It vanishes precisely when things commute. It's sort of complicated when things really don't commute. Does that make sense? Okay, so that's one. And then another nice group that one likes to think about is two generators, no relations. And of course, I'm not writing down the things that come for free from groupiness, like that AA inverse cancel out. So this means no additional relations. Okay, so we know and love this as which group? This is the free group of rank 2, the free non-abelian group of rank 2. And the third group that is really my favorite group, and hopefully will be yours too, is what if I take two generators just like these, and what I do is I only put down the following relation. Instead of the commutator of A and B being trivial, in this group they won't commute, but what I'll do is I'll say that this is central, i.e. this commutator commutes with everything in the group. Okay, is that clear what I mean by that? Okay, so if I write the commutator of A and B, and actually for short, I'm going to abbreviate this C. Let me just use, when I'm talking about this group, I'm going to use the additional notation C to denote the commutator of A and B. Everybody okay with that? It's not a generator. It's just shorthand for this. So, you know, A squared CB equals A squared BC. C is central, it commutes, I can move it anywhere in the group under this relation. Okay, is this group familiar to those of you who don't hang out with me a whole lot? Okay, maybe you haven't seen this group before, but you're gonna love it. This is called the Heisenberg group. If you have seen it before, you might have seen it looking differently. So here's how you might have seen it. It's got this nice representation as 3x3 matrices. So A is this matrix where you don't see an entry, that's a zero. Well, let me write them in for now, but I will. I announce my intention to be lazy about that in the future. Okay, so A can be represented this way, B as this other elementary matrix. And if you actually do the matrix multiplication, you'll see these don't commute, as matrix multiplication tends not to. These don't commute. A times B pops a 1 into the corner, B times A doesn't. And if you actually do the multiply the four matrices that you need to work out the commutator, what you'll see is that C is this matrix. That's just a check that you can and should do that I should have put on the exercises. Okay, so I claim that this is literally a group representation of this group into 3x3 matrices, so that what you'll see, well, is this matrix here commutes with everything in the group. What these generate is the group HZ equals 1, 1, 1, Z, Z, Z. Okay, so by taking products of A and B, you can get arbitrary integers in these three positions, but everything's going to stay unipotent upper triangular.
Sorry, I missed the definition of central.
Central means commutes with everything.
Oh.
Thanks for asking, and please keep asking questions like that. Questions? I love this group. Okay, yeah.
I guess without being do you need that representation to show that set of generators in relation to generating a non-trivial group? Like how?
Okay, so one of my themes today is decision problems in groups. So let me just advertise this quickly. So this is called a group presentation. And it's pretty easy to see that there can be different looking presentations which present isomorphic groups. There are three classic decision problems, algorithmic decision problems for groups. One of them is called the word problem. The word problem in groups is I give you some presentation like this, and then I write down a string of generators, and I ask you, perform all possible rules. Does that actually cancel down to the identity element? This is, we know since the 1950s, generally undecidable. There are groups for which there's no algorithm possible to decide whether a string of generators represents the identity. That's the word problem. I'm not going to write these down, but let me advertise them for a moment. There's also the conjugacy problem. If I give you two group elements, deciding whether they're conjugate in the group. And then the third, and relevant to your question, is the isomorphism problem. If I give you two different group presentations, just deciding whether they present isomorphic groups. Also badly undecidable. So these are not just hard, they're undecidable problems in general. Actually, this can be a very artificial way to talk about groups, is if what you care about is groups up to isomorphism, but it's one of the best tools we have. Yeah. Well, how do you know when you've tried enough? That's the problem, right? So that algorithm can hang and sort of fail to conclusively give you.
Oh, yeah. Right. So you can't
decide this. That's right. Exactly. Right. Oh, so good point. Let me repeat that back. So the question was, can't you just try everything? Which is true. You certainly can. And what that will, what you can see is that if you take something that's eventually that does represent the identity word, and you just try everything, eventually you'll find out that it's the identity. But if you take something that's not the identity word, you have no way of knowing whether you just haven't tried the right thing or whether it's not the identity. So the algorithm's inconclusive in that sense. Does that make sense, everyone? OK, good. So here's the.
Sorry.
Yes?
The question, what's the easiest way to tell that this group is non-trivial?
What's the easiest way to tell that this group is non-trivial?
Is that the question?
Ah, oh, I see. If you use the matrix representation, that's very nice. But let me point out, so this gives me a good opportunity to point out a really nice second way to work with this group without the matrices, which is a very useful tool in group theory in general. This admits a nice normal form. OK, so normal forms are special formats for writing group elements that makes it easy to tell them apart. So let's just make sure we're all on the same page. What's a normal form for the free abelian group? So I here's a, b, a, 15. B minus 1, A. That represents an element of the group. But if you want to sort of keep track of things sensibly, this is a unnecessarily complicated way to write it. How should I write this instead? Yeah, you can add faster than I. Yeah, this is just A17, right? Implicitly, what you're doing is you're realizing that there's a normal form, which looks like A to the I, B to the J. Because they commute, I can put all the A's in front. Another way to say this is that there are coordinates on this group given by the exponents. So I could really just write this as the vector ij, which is another way we like to think about z squared. So that's what a normal form is. It's just a way of sort of writing things in an organized fashion. I don't actually want to talk about languages, but if you like thinking about languages for groups, there's some posters at the back of the room you should admire. But I don't want to talk about it too much in the language of languages. So there's a normal form over here. It's easy. The word problem is very easy here because things that look different are different after you've freely reduced. So how about over here? So an answer to your question is, without using the matrices, there's a nice normal form, which is suggested by what I did here. The nice normal form is a to the I, b to the j, c to the k. How does this work? So I give you some string of a's, b's, and c's even. You pull off, and then you put the a's and the b's in order. This rule says that a inverse b inverse equals c, or in other words, a b equals b a c. So whenever you have a word written out in a's and b's, you can switch the positions of a and b, and it just creates or destroys some c's. So you do this is sort of the word processing point of view on these. you have this normal form, you throw all the A's to the front and the B's after them, and in that grooming process, you create some C's at the end. And so this is actually a nice way without, I mean, it's sort of mathematically equivalent, but it's a nice way without the bookkeeping device of matrices to check whether a word is the identity or to check whether two words are the same. Yes? That's right. So every group element uniquely corresponds to a triple IJK. These give coordinates on the group, and if you know something about nilpotent groups, these are called Malchev coordinates on the nilpotent group. Questions? Great. So these are three different, these are sort of poster children of three different regimes in group theory. This is, of course, abelian. This is a kind of group called hyperbolic. And this is a kind of group called nilpotent. And let me say a little bit more about these three kinds of groups, flavors of groups. You know what abelian means. All elements commute. And I want to think geometrically about abelian groups as being flat. One way to justify that is that you have a nice action of z to the d on the Euclidean space r to the d. And that means that z to d carries a lot of the geometry, a lot of Euclidean geometry around with it. We'll sort of see what I mean by that, but in slogan form, nice action on Euclidean space means it has some intrinsic Euclidean geometry. We can see that in this example by forming the gadget many of you know called the Cayley graph. I talked a little bit about the Cayley graph the other day. The Cayley graph is just, you put down vertices for all the group elements, and you connect them when they differ by a generating letter. So in this case, I have A letters going horizontally and B letters going vertically. And this graph represents this presentation of z squared. This example, I really want us to understand. So are there any questions about how this is a picture of this group presentation? Yes?
This is not a question about that. Can you please move your microphone?
Sure.
So sorry.
No problem. Frida says hello. OK. Any questions? OK. Really? So we see the relation encoded by the fact that A times B is B times A in the picture. And this Cayley graph also, what does this represent in terms of the graph? This is a path in the graph. It represents going A, B, A15, B inverse, A, and you end up at A17. Is that clear? OK, great. So strings of generators are paths in the Cayley graph. And note, the word problem is not only implicitly solved by normal forms, it's implicitly solved by a Cayley graph. If you want to know whether a string of generating letters represents the identity, walk along that string and see if you end up back at the origin. Make sense? Okay, great. Well, what does this look like? So the Cayley graph of the free group of rank 2 with this generating set is a four regular tree, where once again, as over there, I'm going to think of A as going this way and B as going this way. So I could do A to the 17 by just going chook, 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 chook. Oh, this goes on forever. I just got tired of drawing it, right? And I can do any address of A's and B's by walking around appropriately in the tree. Everybody OK with that? You'll build the Cayley graph for this in the exercises, or part of it. But also, if you have your program notes, the brochure that has pictures of us all, I'm hiding behind a Cayley graph of the Heisenberg group in that picture that Dylan Thurston was kind enough to build and ship from Indiana to Boston for me in shredded newspaper. It's a wonderful object that I would have brought if it weren't so delicate. OK. Just a quick word. So this, I said you should think of as flat. Hyperbolic, you should think of as tree-like or saddle-shaped. So just as kind of abelian groups walk around with Euclidean geometry encoded in them because of nice actions on Euclidean space, hyperbolic groups have nice actions on negatively curved spaces. In this case, it's tree-like in that it is a tree. But let me give you a quick out loud example of something that's tree-like but not a tree, just so you have it in mind. So a nice example to have here is the fundamental group of a genus 2 surface, which we've been hearing about from Moira. And a presentation for this is four letters, 1, 2, 3, 4. And it turns out that there's just one relation, which is that the commutator of A and B times the commutator of C and D is the identity. So this turns out to be a nice one-relator presentation of the fundamental group of a genus 2 surface. And how you get to think about this is nice. You have this octagonal tiling, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, yay. You have this octagonal tiling of the hyperbolic plane that some of you will be familiar with. If you haven't seen this, it's such a fundamental example that I'd like you to have. So come talk to me. Okay, great, I wasn't here this morning. Great, so you have this lovely presentation and it gives you this octagonal tiling of the hyperbolic plane. And here's the tree likeness of it that I just want to highlight for you for this purpose. Now, as you walk around from octagon to octagon, it's not the case, like in a tree, that you can't make a cycle. You can make a non-trivial cycle as you walk around here from octagon to octagon. It's just that you pay a heavy detour price. So closing up cycles takes lots and lots of length. Okay, so there are kind of, just like over here, there are efficient highways for getting around. Here, there are also detours off the highway, but they're just extremely long. So it's tree-like in that sense. The efficient ways of getting around look like a tree, and the detours are expensive. And so I think these are two examples, two really nice basic examples to have in mind. Okay. So, let's count. We'll be studying the growth function beta n and the growth function sigma n. And when I want to think about these as sequences, I'm going to sometimes write them beta sub n and sigma sub n. So this is just when I think about them as functions, and this is when I think about them as sequences indexed by n. And remembering what these are, this counts how many group elements you can spell in up to n letters. And this counts how many group elements you can spell in precisely n letters, but not n minus 1. Okay? And we can now, in terms of the Cayley graphs, we can think about these geometrically. This is the size of the ball of radius n in the Cayley graph. Right? Because the Cayley graph has this path metric on it that says that edges have length 1. So the size of the ball of radius n is just exactly asking how many positions can you get to in n steps. That's the exact same question. And this is the size of the sphere. Okay, let's do an example. Well, let me redraw this picture. Let's do some z squared examples quickly. So let's consider z squared with those generators, which I'm going to call its standard generators. Okay, z squared with its standard generators. Well, we talked about this picture before. So here are the positions you can get to in one step. Here are the positions you can get to in two steps. Here are the positions you can get to in three steps. So what is beta n? We can count this, but let's not. Let's observe that we already did the work, right? So this is precisely equal to the Ehrhart polynomial for this polytope. Okay, let's pause and let that sink in. Think about what that is. I take this square here, and I dilate it, and I count the lattice points inside. I'm simultaneously doing two things. The Ehrhart problem for that shape, and counting the number of positions in this group I can reach with n letters. Does everybody see that? This is like a fundamental example for what I want to do next. So this is G diamond of n. It's the Earhart polynomial. Any questions? Okay, so is counting that easy all the time? Or was this especially geometric somehow example? That's a basic question for you to think about. All right, so first, let's not try other groups. Let's stick to this group, z squared. Is this always gonna work? Why or why not? So always means for non-standard generators. Sure, z squared, some other generating set. For instance, I could look at the chestnut generators that we talked about before, right? So there are lots of alternate generating sets for z squared. Doesn't have to be the standard one. Another generating set for z squared is I could allow the moves 1, 0, 0, 1, and 1, 1. And their inverses. And hop around that way. That changes, as we've seen, that changes the count. These functions implicitly depend on both G and S, right? And so my question is, if I change to some other generating set, would my group counting problem be geometric in this way? Does it always get counted by an Earhart polynomial? Does the question make sense now? First of all, great, you get a different type of polyhedron. So let's look at one of those alternate examples. So let's consider z squared. And let's take the alternate generating set, 1, 0, that I just mentioned, 0, 1, 1, 1. And I always take the elements and their inverses. So when I take those three, I get the Cayley graph is a little more complicated than this. I still have these edges in the Cayley graph. Does everybody see that? But I also have these edges in the Cayley graph. Right? So I also have these diagonal edges in the Cayley graph going this way, but not the opposite way. Everybody with me? Do you see what I'm doing? So the positions that I can reach form a different shape. So first of all, where are the positions I can reach in one move? Well, if I start here at the origin, then I can reach these six positions in one move. Everybody see what's going on? OK, what are the positions I can reach in one more move? Well, I can reach these positions in one more move. Well, if I suggestively connect those up to form a hexagon, I can see that these form a larger dilated hexagon.
Sorry, so do we change
our S or G, they have different shape? Do we have a very good approximation, like an upper bound or lower bound for the change of S and the move? So you're asking, when I change generators, I'll get a new shape. You'd like an upper bound for what? For the counting problem?
Yeah.
That's exactly what we're talking about. Yeah, good question. Hold it in mind. Yeah?
It's not so clear that you get dilated polygons, especially for, you know, let's say chestnut generators.
OK, good. But sticking with this example for a moment, look, it magically worked. So the hexagon that I got at the first stage and all the points that I got in the second stage actually just formed, they sat as all the lattice points on successive dilates of a shape. And I hope you see in this example, now we'll take the greens and go up north, south, east, west, or northeast, or southwest. And I hope you see that at the next stage, you'll end up here. And so on. OK, so in this case, we got lucky again. And it was the case that for these hexagonal generators, beta hex n was also an Earhart polynomial exactly, but one for a different shape, in particular for this hexagon. Does everyone understand what's going on? Okay, but indeed, Dave, well said, this won't always happen. Okay, so let's think about for a second why the chess knight example looks a little different. I'm not gonna try to draw the picture, but I have online pictures. I have actually movies of this if you wanna see what it looks like. But let me say out loud why this doesn't always work, and in particular, chess gives us a counterexample. So the issue is, here, we were able to stratify the plane by these layers and neatly organize the points according to which they fall on. The problem with chess knight generators is the 8 original chess knight moves form an octagon, but it might take several steps to get to some of the positions inside that octagon. The octagon's not filled in. Does that make sense, everyone? Okay, so I want you to play around with this on the exercises and think about that. Nonetheless, we get a bound. Okay, so let's write down the bound that we get. So what is beta chess of n? Well, it's complicated to say exactly what it is, but we'll think more about it as we go. But it's certainly no more than the Earhart polynomial that we get from the convex hull of the generators. And in fact, this is always true. Okay, so if you take an arbitrary generating set, and then you take the figure that you get from its convex hull, of course you can get, of course, but you'll think about this. You can get no more, you can get to no more positions with those S moves than you could have by taking their convex hull and dilating it an appropriate number of times. Okay, great. Not equal in general. Any questions about this? Yes? Good question. So this argument here that I sketched out was for z squared, aka z squared. How much does it generalize? Is this going to work immediately in other settings? Let's find out. No. So this works just exactly the same way in z to the d, because the theory of Earhart polynomials carries over just fine to arbitrary dimension, and it's going to fail spectacularly in settings where there's no such thing as rescaling. Punchline of the talks, where I'm going with this. It turns out, through some beautiful mathematics of Gromov and others, that the class of groups in which you can rescale has a name. It's called nilpotent groups. Okay? So the goal of these lectures is to convince you that there's some sort of geometrization that you can do in the interest of counting in precisely this class of groups. Okay, and I should say abelian are a subclass of nilpotent groups. Yes?
Is that because you can embed the KD graph in R2D instead of like
No, but I'll develop the theory a little bit more, but in short, just to say the phrase, it's because the asymptotic admits a metric similarity. And that's a characterization of nilpotent groups, which is really cool. We'll get there. Yeah?
For convex, do you mean from the Euclidean metric?
I do. Yeah, okay, so thanks for asking. So to be clear, so this is the group theoretic counting problem. This is the Earhart polynomial for, I have the generators, they're lattice points in z to the d. I take their convex hull in R to the D and I get a polytope. So this is an Earhart polynomial. Okay, I wanted to tell you one more piece of good news about the relationship here. So this is a fairly weak relationship perhaps, and something much better is true. In fact, not only is there a bound here, but it's pretty argument, but not one that I want to give you now because I'm going in a slightly different direction. They actually agree to first order. That's much stronger than this, right? This is a polynomial that starts, this starts a d n to the d. In fact, it's the volume times n to the d plus lower order terms. And so what this fact is telling you is that this group theoretic counting function should actually be thought of as like a discrete volume. What it's picking up is precisely the volume of the convex hull that's growing polynomially with that coefficient. Okay, well, this is a statement for z to the d, and I'm building towards what to say in nilpotent groups. Questions? Yeah?
Is there a statement for why equality holds here? Like,
yeah.
The determinant of two of them is one.
Great question. When does equality hold here? Can I ask you again after you've had a little time to play with it? Because the exercises will get you thinking about that. But that's a really good question to have in mind. When do they agree? If you want to read, again, like I said, I'm not going to sort of develop this, but if you want to read about this, there's a paper by myself, Lelievre and Mooney, not me, another person, where we explain this in very elementary terms. I just had an undergraduate reading it this semester. It really is quite accessible if you're interested. The name of the paper is like Geometry of Spheres in Free Abelian Groups, and now you can see why it's called that. Good. So, so now I've introduced some classes of groups, the counting problem we want to study, and some nice facts that give us access to approximating it and bounding it in the special case of free abelian groups. Okay, so now with the rest of today's time, I want to start surveying some of what's known about both growth rate and rationality in groups. And then next time, I'll prove some things that related to growth in the nilpotent class. Okay, so here's some history. Okay, so an important, some of this stuff I've already mentioned, but let me consolidate it all into one place. So a question that's sometimes attributed to Milner from the, I think, late 50s is, do any groups have beta growing faster than any polynomial? But slower than exponentials? Answer, due to Grigorchuk from the 1980s, so this took a while, yes. So Grigorchuk introduced a class of self-similar groups that grow like e to the square root of n. Okay, and as I mentioned before, there's a dichotomy in rational growth between having poles inside the unit circle, that gives you exponential growth, and not, that gives you polynomial growth range. And so these groups are automatically, these can't be rational. Any questions? Okay. Next very reasonable question, actually really it comes before this, is how does this depend on the choice of generators? And the answer, which is usually attributed to Milner and Schwartz, is that, so question, what does how does the beta depend on the generators? How can it change when you change the generators? And I'll be brief about this answer, although you can explore this also on the exercises. The answer is it can change. This thing over here has area 2, so the leading term of the growth is 2n squared. This thing over here has area 3. So the leading term of growth is 3n squared. You guys with me? So it can change, but those are both quadratic. And of course, it'll always be quadratic for any generating set and z squared. So the answer is there's an equivalence relation on functions that preserves polynomiality and the degree of polynomiality, and the change of generating sets only produces equivalent growth functions. So that's nice. So now I can talk about whether a group has polynomial growth. I don't have to refer to a generating set to make sense of that. Does that make sense? So this is just QI invariance. Yeah. So linear rescaling of domain. So intermediate certainly stays intermediate. Okay, so what else might we want to know? So question, which groups have growth in the polynomial range? So remember, this is what I was calling yesterday slow growth. I don't mean that the growth is precisely polynomial. I just mean beta of n is bounded above by some polynomial. Okay, so one theorem, which is attributed to Bass and Givarch, is all nilpotent groups do. Okay, so this is a good moment for me to pause and tell/remind you what nilpotent means. Question?
I have a question about the last.
Yes, please.
So what if they are not polynomial growth?
Oh yeah, that was his question too.
Oh, sorry.
No, that's totally fine. No.
Yeah, I was thinking, well,
as you should be. this equivalence relation that you can study on the exercises if you want to get your hands on it, preserves the property of being intermediate as well.
Okay.
Does it preserve the square root?
Actually, interesting story. So this was a big breakthrough of Grigorchuk in the 1980s. And since then, a lot of time and energy has gone into looking for more intermediate examples. And now there are some sort of cosmetically different ones, but all the known examples grow at this rate, which is pretty interesting conjecture. That's the only possible intermediate rate. Prove it, and fame and glory will be heaped upon your head. Right. Okay, so let me tell you what, any more questions? They're really welcome. Okay, so let me take a moment and tell/remind you what nilpotent groups are. Okay, so what's nilpotent? In words first, a million were things where everything commutes. Nilpotent groups are ones where the failure only goes so deep, i.e., if I take commutators, that might not kill everything. But if I take commutators of commutators of commutators 5 times, and after that, I've only got the trivial word left, the group is 5-step nilpotent. Okay, so let me write that down. What does this mean? Nilpotent of step S means whenever I take commutators of commutators of commutators, if I do this with, well, let's see, a billion should be 1-step nilpotent, so this should have S plus one arguments. Okay, does everyone understand this expression? This is just a nested commutator, and it's got these different spots that I left for arguments. If you fill in any S plus one group elements, and that is dead, i.e. the identity, then we say the group is nilpotent of step at most S. Right, so let's unravel that for one sec. So again, nilpotent of step one, what does it mean? It means when I put in two arguments here, i.e. I just have a single commutator, if I put in any two things to a single commutator, I get one. Rephrased, that says every two group elements commute. Rephrased, that says the group is abelian. Okay, so nilpotent of step one equals abelian. How about that lovely group that I was so clever as not to erase? What happens over here? Well, if I take commutators once, I didn't kill everything, right? I have this surviving element. But it commutes with everything. So the commutator of C with anything at all is trivial, right? So I just had to take a commutator once, twice. So this is two-step nilpotent. Questions? Okay, so here's an example that I want you to play with, because really the thrust of the rest of these lectures is mostly about this class of groups. Here's another fun nilpotent group. The five-parameter Heisenberg group. How does that work? It doesn't sit in 5x5 matrices, it sits in 4x4 matrices. The number 5 comes because it's got these five parameters. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So this one has three parameters, 1, 2, 3, and H5 has five parameters, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Everybody understand what's going on? Okay, so I want you to play, so what's the step of nilpotency here? Well, a little bit of matrix multiplication will convince you the following. If you take any commutator of unipotent upper triangular matrices, little observation, multiplication of such matrices is additive on the first super diagonal. Okay, so if I multiply two matrices of this form, the elements that are right above the diagonal just add when I multiply. You can check this, and you should. But that means that if I take a commutator, what am I doing? Plus, plus, minus, minus. So taking a commutator clears a super diagonal of zeros. You guys get that? Taking another one will clear the next one of zeros. And so if I take commutators three times, all that's left is the identity matrix. Everybody get that? Okay, so this has step at most 3, right? And for the same reason, this had step at most 2. But maybe this has step 2. Exercise. Okay, any questions all about the setup? So let me tell you two universality facts about nilpotent groups. Of course, I should say, if you've studied nilpotent groups in classes, you might have seen them in the context of nilpotent Lie groups. I'm looking here at finitely generated nilpotent groups, but I'll explain how the subjects fit together. So a couple of universality facts. Here's one. I can get any finitely generated group at all by starting with the free group and imposing some relations. So the free group is universal in the class of finitely generated groups. It surjects onto every group by imposing appropriate relations. The universal object in the class of nilpotent groups, you'll never believe it, is called the free nilpotent group. Okay, and let me tell you what it is. It's very easy to say. The free nilpotent group is simply what you'd get the free group and added all these relations. You make the things commute that have to commute for the definition to be met, and ta-da, that's the free object. So the free nilpotent group. NSM, this is the step of nilpotency, and this is the rank, or the number of generators, is you take the free group of rank M, and you mod out by all the nested commutators with S plus one arguments. okay, let me just say what's going on here. I had to have these dead to be nilpotent. The free nilpotent group has what it has to have and nothing more. Make sense? Okay, you can check. What's the free nilpotent group of step two and rank two? Behold, it's the Heisenberg group. Why? Because look at that presentation. It's like squirting its freeness all over you. It's got rank two, there it is, with its two generators. What are its relations? It's just telling you that AB commutes with everything. Those are the two things that have to be true to make it nilpotent, and those are the only rules I've put down. Any questions? Yes?
So you take a commutator of S plus one steps, and then you set it to identity?
Yep. That's it. And let me point out, let me contrast this. So someone mentioned, Sarah mentioned in her talk, nil and sol geometry, I think. So this is nilpotent. This is the gateway to this to nil geometry. There's this other thing called sol, and I just want to point out, instead of taking commutators of commutators, I could have taken commutators with commutators. I could have taken commutators of commutator with commutator, commutator with commutator with right? And then I'd get solvable. And I'm not going to talk about that, but I just want to point that out. I want to flag that as the difference. Commutators of commutators versus commutators with commutators. Okay. Questions? Okay. So Bass and Givarsh then said, as long as this is true, you have polynomial growth, and the degree of polynomiality just depends on kind of, you can bound it in terms of the step. They write down an actual formula for the degree of polynomial growth, which I won't go into, but I will say by the Bass and Givarsh formula, what is the growth of the Heisenberg group? About how fast does it grow? Well, let's think about what it might be. It's got these three integer positions. So looking at this normal form, it's got coordinates in Z3. So I can actually draw it in R3 if I want. And it's got polynomial growth. So maybe it ought to be n cubed, right? That would be our first guess. Okay, but it's going to turn out that there's a little bit of twisting going on here that makes it actually into the fourth growth. And in fact, if you play with that five-parameter Heisenberg group, you'll find that it has five parameters, but it has n to the sixth growth. Okay, nonetheless, for sort of fundamental reasons, all nilpotent groups have polynomial growth. Any questions about this? Okay, and then this remarkable theorem. Yes, just one sec.
Do I need an equal
to 5? Yeah, you can do this for any odd integer. But by that, look at the pattern. In 4x4s, it's got 5 parameters. In 5x5s, it has 7 parameters. This is just, these are called the higher Heisenberg groups. This is just one family of nilpotent groups, but it's a particularly nice family of examples. Other questions? Note there's an NSM for every step in rank. I just constructed it. Right? Everybody okay with this? So, right, I should have also written it this way, just to go with what I was doing before. All you do is take M generators and the nested commutators that you need. So that's the presentation for the free nilpotent group of any step in rank. Any other questions before?
Five-step group, if you got rid of that middle zero and put a Z in there, so it had 6 dimensions.
So it had 6 parameters, yeah. You gotta be careful with dimensions. There's so many different conflicting notions of dimension running around. But yeah, so if you put, okay, good.
So you just had a
Gromov can wait. Gromov can wait. So this is a great question, and it raises this other kind of universality statement that I really should mention because it's super fundamental. This fact about commutators clearing an extra super diagonal of zeros shows us that any upper triangular unipotent integer group is nilpotent, right? As long as it's got ones on the diagonal and integers above, and it's a group, it's automatically nilpotent for these structural reasons. Okay, and it turns out by fundamental Lie theory, actually, that it goes the other way too. So any torsion-free nilpotent group embeds in an upper triangular matrix group. So that's another nilpotent group. It's not part of this family, but it's perfectly respectable. Torsion-free means everything has infinite order. There's no finite order, right? As if I'm putting Z's here.
Is it free nilpotent? Is it one of the NSMs?
It is absolutely not one of the NSMs. And here's I enjoy this sidetrack very much. I've been thinking very intensely about nilpotent groups for the last 7 years or something. There are lots of different communities that think about nilpotent groups. But the GGT, the geometric group theory community that I came up through, I feel the subject is underappreciated. So I'm here to proselytize. Here's an invariant of a nilpotent group. Well, I can hand you a nilpotent group and ask you, what's its rank? And then I'm asking, what's the smallest number of generators that you need to present it? Okay. I can hand you a nilpotent group, and I can ask you, what's its step? And then I'm asking, how many times do you need to bash it with this process to kill everything? Does that make sense? Okay, a third thing I can ask you is, what's its dimension? So if it's torsion-free, i.e. if all of its elements have infinite order, then I can ask you, what's the smallest matrix group I can embed it in? You would be astonished at how little we know. So I don't even know the answer for the free nilpotent groups. And I've checked the literature and asked experts around the world. That's embarrassing. And if anyone here wants to think about that with me, I would be delighted. OK, did you guys understand the statement? The dimension is just the smallest matrix group you can cram your group into. There are papers that give really inefficient upper bounds on the dimension, algorithmically. But it's actually a hard question and an interesting one. Is it the same as?
As the lowest representation?
I guess certainly the people I've been asking are representation theorists. So yeah, this is, you can phrase this as a question about group representations. Yeah, about the dimension of the group representation. Okay, I have the last minute to go back to the not really very neglected Gromov. So let me state Gromov's theorem, because it is nice. So Gromov's theorem is the converse to Bassin-Givarch. Okay, so Gromov's theorem says, not only do nilpotent groups have polynomial growth, but anything in the polynomial growth range is virtually nilpotent. Polynomially bounded growth, if and only if, virtually, and virtually means up to a finite index subgroup, nilpotent. How does he prove this? He creates this whole bunch of machinery, which in my language says, what he shows is that if you're polynomially bounded, it's because you come from an Ehrhart-like enumeration problem on a space with a dilation, and all of those spaces are associated to nilpotent groups. That's actually, in my language, how his proof works. Okay, I'll say a little more about this. And actually, there's one more thing I want to tell you before we go. But first, are there any questions about this? This theorem, which is from the early 1980s, is kind of responsible for a giant boom of geometric group theory, because virtually nilpotent, that's a super duper algebraic property. But slow growth, that's slow volume growth, that's geometric. So he got this really strong kind of dictionary between this algebraic property and this geometric property. And that was extremely inspiring for this whole now very vast area of mathematics. Okay, so the statement is, if the betas are bounded by a polynomial, then up to passing to finite index, the group is nilpotent. Yes?
Can you say anything about what is the number of steps based on the degree of the polynomial?
Yes, and let's talk about that later. That's basically unraveling the Bassin-Givarch formula. Okay? All right, so now let me just finish with this. Great, so now we've talked about how fast. But remember rationality? So here, often we got actual Earhart polynomials, and that means often we got rational growth. All right, so a theorem that I'll say now and write down next time. In the early 80s, there was a giant wave of attention to the question, when are growth functions rational? Who cares? Again, because if they're rational, you can build out the Cayley graph, you can solve the decision problems, you like win in the game of math, right? So when are these rational? So theorems of Cannon, Thurston, and Gromov from the early 80s tell us all hyperbolic groups are rational in any generators. Stunning, because remember how hard it is to show things are rational? So this is a statement for the whole class of hyperbolic groups. Arbitrary generators always have rational growth. Those are three big names. Then there's this guy that, sadly, you probably haven't heard of, named Max Benson. And he proved the same thing for virtually abelian groups. All virtually abelian groups. It wasn't just a coincidence with their Earhart polynomials. All virtually abelian groups, all generating sets, always rational growth. All of that had been proved by 1984, which is a little over 30 years ago, and there were no more examples for 30 years of groups that are always rational. Okay, now there's one more example, and it's this group right here. It's the only known example that's neither hyperbolic nor virtually abelian, but nonetheless is always rational. Okay, and so that's a theorem of mine and my collaborator Mike Shapiro. And I'll give you the tools to understand it and show you some cool pictures and explain why it's true and why the prospects for pushing that further are bleak in the last lecture. Okay, thanks.